Good day, this is Jim Pytel from Columbia Gorge Community College. This is Digital Electronics 1. This lecture is entitled Digital Waveform Examples. And this is not really a lecture, this is Hogan's Alley. And you got to get from one end of Hogan's Alley to the other end, shooting all the mustachioed bad guys, not shooting the cowering hostages, and not shooting the lady with the baby. Okay, so here's the deal. I got a bunch of waveforms here. What I want you to do is figure out, for A, I want you to figure out what is the period. What is the pulse width? What is the frequency? And the duty cycle. For waveform B, what I want you to do is figure out, oh my gosh, the period, the pulse width, the frequency, and duty cycle. For waveform C, I've given you the frequency. I've given you the duty cycle. Obviously, I want you to figure out the period, the pulse width, and I want you to draw it, okay? So go ahead and pause the lecture at this time. Go ahead and knock these things out, because what I'm gonna do is go ahead and perform the calculations necessary to come up with the correct answers. Now I'm serious, man, pause it. Don't let me sit around and don't sit around, just wait for me to do this work for you. I'll wait for you. Okay, so I'm back. All right, hopefully you're gonna come up with the same answers that I do here. Okay, key to understanding this digital waveforms examples is this piece of data right here. What is the time data? It's milliseconds on the first one. Okay, so that is 0 to 5 milliseconds. It repeats itself. 5 milliseconds. Our period is 5 milliseconds. Say you don't want to start at 0. Say you want to start at 1. Well, it still takes 5 milliseconds, okay? What is the pulse width, the time it's on? If we count each block as 1, 2, 3, it's off for 3, it's on for 4, 5, so it's on for 2 milliseconds. Now our frequency, what is the frequency? Frequency is 1/T. What is the period, excuse me, the frequency of something that has a period of 5 milliseconds, 1/5 milliseconds? You should be getting 200 hertz. What's the duty cycle for something that shows up 2 milliseconds of every 5 milliseconds? It typically expresses percentage. You should be getting 40% duty cycle. So hopefully you did not shoot the lady with the baby and you got the mustachioed bad guy on that one. Hopefully you've done the calculations for this guy already. What is the period of B? Well, it's microseconds this time, okay? And by the way, that's a micro also. So microseconds, so from 500 microseconds to 750 microseconds sounds like it's a period of 250 microseconds. 250, everywhere it is, it's 250 microseconds. Okay, 250 microseconds sounds a lot more than 5 milliseconds, but it's not. Micro, 10 to the negative 6. Milli, 10 to the negative 3. So 250 microseconds is actually 0.25 milliseconds. Okay, so obviously 5 milliseconds is a longer period than something that has 0.25 microseconds. Oh, excuse me, 0.25 milliseconds or 250 microseconds. So B is going faster than A. Stands to conjecture that our frequency would be substantially faster. Is that true? Frequency? 1/T. What is the frequency of something with a 250 microsecond period? It should be 4 kilohertz. What is a kilo? Times 10 to the 3, 4,000 hertz. Okay, so 250 microsecond period. How much is the pulse actually there? Well, if that's 1 block, 2 blocks, 3 blocks, 4 blocks, 5 blocks, stands to conjecture that each block is 50 microseconds long. What is the duty cycle? Where it's 50 microseconds of every 250 microseconds times 100%. The duty cycle is 20%. So hopefully you got those right. Slight little twist here. We have I'm telling you, I want a waveform of 125 kilohertz, and I want a duty cycle of 75%. Problem C is substantially more important than A and B, because you're going to be asked to set up waveforms on the function generator and using the oscilloscope, which is kind of like a timing diagram, to create a waveform. So I'm going to tell you, make a waveform that's 125 kilohertz that has a duty cycle of 75%. So it's Hogan's Alley right now. It's a test. It's a life or death situation in the lab, guys. You got to be able to do this thing without a lot of pausing. Okay, how do I do this? So if the frequency is 125 kilohertz, I want the period, T, 1 over F. It's an inverse relationship. What I'm getting is 8 microseconds. So every 8 microseconds, it should repeat itself. What's our graph? Shows it in microseconds. So every 8 microseconds, so if each block is 2, 4, 6, 8, it's going to repeat itself every 8. 2, 4, 6, 8, 2, 4, 6, 8, 2, 4, 6, 8, so on and so forth. That's when it's going to repeat itself. With a duty cycle of 75%, it's showing up 75% of the time. So 0.75 times 8 microsecond, my pulse width, T, should be 6 microseconds. So it's going to be there for 2, 4, 6, off for 2. 2, 4, 6, off for 2. Now I say this is a more important problem than the others, is because you are predicting what you'd expect. So if your waveform, if you set up your function generator to 125 kilohertz, duty cycle 75%, and you don't see this, you got something wrong. Either something's wrong with your function generator, or something's wrong with your oscilloscope, or something's wrong with your calculations, okay? So crucial to your understanding is how to back and forth between period, pulse width, frequency, and duty cycle. And if I give you the frequency, you should be able to calculate the period and calculate the pulse width based on the frequency and duty cycle. Okay, so those are our digital waveform examples, doing period, frequency, duty cycle calculations. Now let's go on to some timing diagram examples. Okay, so here is a big old mess of digital pulses. And like I said earlier, digital electronics is about staying organized. This right here, I've got 5 data signals. Imagine something with 32 data signals. Staying organized is absolutely critical to it. And all I'm asking you to do is kind of look at this thing and get a feel for what the values are simultaneously. This is a timing diagram showing what I'm going to do is I'm going to call these certain. That's data A. And I could call this one B, but let's say they're all part of the same code. That's also A. That's also A. That's also A. That's also A. What I'm saying is these things are all packaged together. A, this quantity A, is composed of 5 bits. So what I'm going to do is kind of keep them together. And how I typically do this and how most data sheets do this, we start with an LSB, and we will go into this. An LSB is the least significant bit. It's the lowest place, I guess. We'll go into this, don't worry about it. And all I do is kind of walk up A0, A1, A2, A3, A4. So even though I started at 0 and ended at 4, okay, you don't really, some manufacturers do. Some manufacturers start at 1 and walk up to 5. I'd kind of like to keep it at 0, okay? So most of my lectures you'll see me do, unless I'm referencing some manufacturer that actually does start at 1, I'm going to start at 0. You can call it whatever. You can call it A blue, A gold, A red. I don't care. Just somehow stay organized. This is how I stay organized. At what time region, just look at this diagram, at what time region is everybody a 0? What I'm going to do is just circle something here. Everybody's a 0 right here between that region. Because if you look at it, A4 is a 0, a 0, a 0, a 0, and a 0. Now, obviously the next question is, when is everybody a 1? Over at this end right here. So I got 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. Now, just kind of look through things here and scan this whole thing again. Do you see any other spots potentially where there's a zeros and all ones? So I'll go ahead and just go ahead and pause it and find it. And I'm going to go ahead and pause. Okay, so hopefully you didn't pause it for very long because there is no other spot where they're all simultaneously zero and all simultaneously ones. Okay, so one of the things I want to introduce right now is this concept of MSB and LSB. Okay, so if I was to tell you the number 642 or 642, you would realize I meant 642 and not 246. Okay, I'm giving a place weight to them, i.e. the most significant bit, the one with the that's called the MSB, most significant bit, and the LSB, the one to the left has the greatest place weight. So it's 600 for tens to one, 642. Same thing with binary. We could go ahead and what I'm going to do is going to say MSB to LSB. I'm going to tell you the number from MSB to LSB, just like I do in regular decimal numbers. So I'm going to say MSB A4, A3, A2, A1, A0. I want you to look for a spot where it's 0, 1, 0, 0, 0. MSB to LSB. I'm not going to tell you 0, 0, 0, 1, 0. I'm going to tell you 0, 1, 0, 0, 0. You've already seen, this is just 5 bits, guys. This is not 32 bits. You've already seen it's kind of confusing when you're dealing with large quantities of these things. We're going to show you shortcuts later on, so how you can express large numbers in a binary format using some shortcuts. Okay, so find a spot on this graph, or in this timing diagram, where it's 0, 1, 0, 0. So what you're going to do, just think of a bracketing approach. Start at the MSB. Where is A40? In this big old region here. Where is A31 within that bracket? Okay, so I'm sticking within this bracket. Where is A31 in that bracket? Right there. Move it up. Where is A20 within those two brackets? Right there. I'm narrowing my window down. See, I started off with a big window, progressively smaller window, progressively smaller window. Where's A10 within those bracket right there? Finally, right there. Okay, that is the one and only time within this graph, this region right here, where I have the binary number 01000. Okay, so go ahead and find a spot on the timing diagram where it's 00101. That answer is right there. 00101. This is confusing, I'll admit. You've got 5 bits taking different values over the time, but it's readable. It's quasi-readable because I'm using different colors. Imagine if I used all black on these things. The point being, don't use all the same wires in your digital electronic circuits. Additionally, use the multi-channel oscilloscopes. If you're trying to simultaneously display something on an oscilloscope, use those color tags on the oscilloscope. There's all these pastel colors, which disgust me. Take those pink things, those clips, or those aqua things, and go ahead and put those on there so you know which signal it is, okay? And so you can display it on those oscilloscopes, those multi-channel oscilloscopes, with the correct color. And again, staying organized. If A0 is now the clock on those positive edges, and don't stress so much about the positive edges and negative edges just yet. That's more sequential circuits. Just do this quick example here. At that positive edge right there, if A0 represents the clock, what is the value of A1? It's a 1. A2, it's a 1. A3, it's a 0. It's a 0. So 0, 0, 1, 1. You know, your ability to differentiate what is the clock signal, what is a data signal, what's an input, what's an output, absolutely essential. Again, staying organized is key to your success in digital electronics. Okay, so hopefully you survived Hogan's Alley here without any major gaping chest wounds, and we're going to move on to our next lecture in this series.